I'm Dr. Mark Atala, and I want to welcome you to my office. I'm a cognitive scientist who studies time travel and retrocausality, which is how the future impacts the present and the past. And today what I want to talk to you about is learning and how it's actually a retrocausal phenomenon. But let's get started by talking about Edward Thorndike, who really comes up with the first theory of how learning occurs in a psychological context. And he was at Columbia. This is in 1898. And his theory is what's called connectionism, because he wants to figure out the relationship and the associations between essentially situations and responses. And so he takes a bunch of fruit crates that he calls puzzle boxes, and then he puts cats into them. Now, each puzzle box has a different combination to get out of it. So, for example, a cat might have to jump on top of a box and then whack at a string, and then boom, the door opens and he gets out of the box and he can eat a piece of fish. That's his reward. So what Thorndike says is that what's occurring, he says it's not so much that it's a trial and error process, but he says it's not so much trial and error as it is trial and accidental success, and that this is how much of learning occurs, that the food stamps in the correct response, that because they're rewarded, they are more likely, next time they're put into that same puzzle box, they'll know to jump up on top of the box and whack the string and the door will open and they get the piece of fish. So he develops what's called the law of effect, which says that any behavior which is followed by a satisfier, what he calls a satisfier, is likely to be repeated. Now, if that sounds familiar, it's because B.F. Skinner relabels it as positive reinforcement, puts a couple permutations on it, and then that becomes operant conditioning. But people at the time were critical of Thorndike's findings. So, for example, Edwin Ray Guthrie, he believed in what he called temporal contiguity, that things had to come together in time for associations to be formed. And he raised the criticism, which I think is correct. He says that if the cat jumped on top of the box, hit the string, and then 5 minutes later the door opened and he got the fish, then he would never have learned that association. It's only because the door opening immediately follows him whacking the string. And so he says that the reward doesn't stamp in learning, it prevents unlearning. And so that this information that time is what's important, temporal contiguity, things coming together in time. Another contemporary psychologist who saw problems with this theory is Wolfgang Kohler. And he said, the problem with Thorndike's research is that the animal has no insight into how to solve the problem. And so therefore, they have to solve the problem through trial and error. And he says, that's not how learning occurs. That's not how I learn things. I learn through insight. And he gives the example, he does a whole bunch of research with chimpanzees to show that they have insight learning. And he publishes it in a book called Mentality of Apes. But I'll give you a human example. He talks about the story of Archimedes and the crown. And if you're not familiar with it, I'll give you a very brief version of it. So Archimedes is a Greek philosopher, and he's living in Syracuse, which is a town in southern Sicily. The king of Syracuse gets a crown as a gift. And he wants to know if it's real gold. And so he gives it to Archimedes and he says, I want you to figure out if this is really gold or not, or if it's got other things mixed in with it, but I don't want you to melt it down. And Archimedes is thinking about it, and he can't figure out how to determine whether it's really gold or not without melting it down. So he decides to just take a bath, relax, and try to figure it out that way. And actually, Kohler calls that incubation. That incubation allows your subconscious to work on the problem, and then you'll have an insight, an aha experience, and that's how you'll see the correct answer. Which, just to talk about this for a second, it's actually a retrocausal, incubation's a retrocausal phenomenon, because it allows you to see into the future, a future where you actually solve the problem, how it should be solved. So to go back to Archimedes, he doesn't want to melt the crown down, so he decides to take a bath. As he gets into the water, he realizes that the water level rises, that his weight displaces water. And he jumps out of the bath and he yells, "Eureka," which means I found it. Because what he realizes is that he can take the same weight of gold and see how much water it displaces, and then see how much the crown displaces, and he can figure out if it's real gold based on that. And I don't know if it was real gold. That's not the point of the story, but I don't know what the correct answer is. So that's what Kohler says. He says that the situation is so strange that the animal can't properly solve the problem. Now, another researcher, let's talk about Edward Tolman too, because I think he has an important advance on this too. Both researchers talk about reinforcement and its importance. Tolman says learning can occur without reinforcement through what he calls latent learning. And the because you don't have to have reinforcement to stamp in the stimulus response bond, that that's a little technical. So let me give you an example of the research that he did that showed latent learning, and I'll explain why it's retrocausal too. So he takes two groups of rats and he has them run a maze. Okay, the first group, let's say it takes 40 trials to successfully learn the maze. Okay, and he's able to plot a grid of how many errors that they make, so and how much time it takes them to run the maze. And so for the first group, there's a goal box that always has cheese at the end. And so you can see the function of their mistakes over time, and they make fewer and fewer mistakes over time until they get to the goal box. And then by the 40th trial, they're able to run it flawlessly. They just put them in the maze and they run straight to the goal box. What latent learning is in, for the second group, the first 20 trials, there's no cheese in the goal box. They're just let to run around in the maze. And do they learn the maze? Well, learning can't occur without reinforcement, so theoretically they don't know the maze at all. On the 20th trial, Tolman puts cheese in the goal box. All of a sudden now, there's a purpose to being in that maze. And what he finds is a much steeper learning curve, that they're running it perfectly by the 40th trial also. So latent learning has occurred. By being in the maze itself, they're learning. And so they reach the same point as people in, as the rats in the first group, but much quicker. And the retrocausal explanation of this is that they knew they were going to be running this maze in the future. And so it wasn't until they had to actually deploy that knowledge by getting reinforced for knowing how to run the maze that they were able to run it correctly and without very many errors. So I want to give a personal example of this same thing. Oh, actually, one other thing I want to say about Tolman is he was criticized because they said, well, you know, maybe maze running in itself is reinforcing for rats. And so he reran the study with cats, putting cats in mazes, cat-sized mazes, and showed the exact same result. And so people stopped criticizing him for that. Here's the personal example. It's from my own life and what a poor college student I was. College for me really was latent learning. Now, I took a lot of classes, and I was actually a triple major, not to brag. I was a psychology, history, and Russian triple major. Yagavaru Paruski, absolutely terribly. My high school French is still better than my college Russian. But I didn't pay that much attention in class. I was a very poor student. Ended up with a 3.1 GPA. I used to make my college girlfriend absolutely insane because I never checked to see how well I did on tests. And she used to say, "Don't you care?" And I said that basically grades weren't a reinforcement for me, that I did as well as I could. I was interested in the material. I wanted to take as many classes as I could. So if we skip ahead, I've taught 15 different classes in psychology. I'm a tenured full professor. I've been pretty successful in higher education. How did I go from being a 3.1 GPA student to being able to teach all these different classes in psychology? I think it's essentially latent learning, that I knew the material cold in the future, because once I had to teach the material, I knew it. And knowing it in the future allowed me to remember and do well in my classes in the past. And that's why I don't know my Russian anymore, because I don't use it. It wasn't necessary in the future, whereas the psychology was. So learning, properly understood, is a retrocausal phenomenon. Now, if this seems interesting to you, I would encourage you to check out my book, Psychology and Retrocausality. I'd also encourage you to come visit us on the web at retrocausality.org to see if you are retrocausally sensitive also. If you could like and subscribe and share this video, that would be great. If you'd like to support my research on Patreon, I have a link below. And otherwise, I'll see you in the future and have a great day.